Mr. President, Mr. Secretary General, fellow delegates, ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to address you for the first time as the 44th President of the United States. I come before you humbled by the responsibility that the American people have placed upon me, mindful of the enormous challenges of our moment through history, and determined to act boldly and collectively on behalf of justice and prosperity at home and abroad. I have been in office for just 9 months, though some days it seems a lot longer. I am well aware of the expectations that accompany my presidency around the world. But these expectations are not about me. Rather, they are rooted, I believe, in the discontent with the status quo that has allowed us to be increasingly defined by our differences and outpaced by our problems. But they are also rooted in hope. The hope that real change is possible, and the hope that America will be a leader in bringing about such change. I took office at a time when many around the world had come to view America with skepticism and distrust. A part of this was due to misperception, misinformation about my country. Part of this was due to opposition to specific policies, and the belief that on certain critical issues, America had acted unilaterally without regard to the interests of others. This has fed an almost reflexive anti-Americanism, which too often has served as an excuse for collective inaction. Now, like all of you, my responsibility is to act in the interests of my nation and my people. And I will never apologize for defending those interests. But it is my deeply held belief that in the year 2009, more than at any point in human history, the interests of nations and peoples are shared. The religious convictions that we hold in our hearts can forge new bonds among people, or they can tear us apart. The technology we harness can light the path to peace or forever darken it. The energy we use can sustain our planet or destroy it. What happens to the hope of a single child anywhere can enrich our world or impoverish it. In this hall, we come from many places, but we share a common future. No longer do we have the luxury of indulging our differences to the exclusion of the work that we must do together. I have carried this message from London to Ankara, from Port of Spain to Moscow, from Accra to Cairo, and it is what I will speak about today. Because the time has come for the world to move in a new direction, we must embrace a new era of engagement based on mutual interest and mutual respect, and our work must begin now. We know the future will be forged by deeds, not simply words. Speeches alone will not solve our problems. It will take persistent action. For those who question the character and cause of my nation, I ask you to look at the concrete actions we have taken in just 9 months. On my first day in office, I prohibited, without exception or equivocation, the use of torture by the United States of America. I ordered the prison at Guantanamo Bay closed. We are doing the hard work of forging a framework to combat extremism within the rule of law. Every nation must know. America will live its values, and we will lead by example. We have set a clear and focused goal to work with all members of this body to disrupt, dismantle, and defeat Al Al-Qaeda and its extremist allies, a network that has killed thousands of people of many faiths and nations, that plotted to blow up this very building. In Afghanistan and Pakistan, we and many nations here are helping these governments develop the capacity to take the lead in this effort, while working to advance opportunity and security for their people. In Iraq, we are responsibly ending a war. We have removed American combat brigades from Iraqi cities and set a deadline of next August to remove all our combat brigades from Iraqi territory. And I have made clear that we will help Iraqis transition to full responsibility for their future and keep our commitment to remove all American troops by the end of 2001. I have outlined a comprehensive agenda to seek the goal of a world without nuclear weapons. In Moscow, the United States and Russia announced that we would pursue substantial reductions in our strategic warheads and launchers. At the Conference on Disarmament, we agreed on a work plan to negotiate an end to the production of fissile materials for nuclear weapons. This week, my Secretary of State will become the first senior American representative of the annual members' conference of the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty. Upon taking office, I appointed a special envoy for Middle East peace. America has worked steadily and aggressively to advance the cause of two states, Israel and Palestine, in which peace and security take root and the rights of both Israelis and Palestinians are respected. To confront climate change, we have invested $80 billion in clean energy. We have substantially increased our fuel efficiency standards. We have provided new incentives for conservation, launched an energy partnership across the Americas, and moved from a bystander to a leader in international climate negotiations. To overcome the economic crisis that touches every corner of the world, we worked with the G20 nations to forge a coordinated international response of over $2 trillion in stimulus to bring the global economy back to the brink. We mobilized resources to help prevent the crisis from spreading further to developing countries. We joined with others to launch a $20 billion global food security initiative that will lend a hand to those who need it most and help them build their own capacity. We've also re-engaged the United Nations. We have paid our bills. We have joined the Human Rights Council. We have signed the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. We have fully embraced the Millennium Development Goals, and we address our priorities here in this institution. For instance, through the Security Council meeting that I will chair tomorrow on nuclear nonproliferation and disarmament, and through the issues that I will discuss today. This is what we have already done, but this is just the beginning. Some of our actions have yielded progress. Some have laid the groundwork for progress in the future. But make no mistake, this cannot solely be America's endeavor. Those who used to chastise America for acting alone in the world cannot now stand by and wait for America to solve the world's problems alone. We have sought, in word and deed, a new era of engagement with the world. Now is the time for all of us to take our share of responsibility for a global response to global challenges. If we are honest with ourselves, we need to admit that we are not living up to that responsibility. Consider the course that we're on if we fail to confront the status quo. Extremists sowing terror in pockets of the world, protracted conflicts that grind on and on, genocide, mass atrocities, more nations with nuclear weapons,